Good evening. Can you hear me, everybody?
Yes.
Good evening. I'm thrilled to be here to present the award of Humanist of the Year to Dr. Michael Mann. Why does he deserve it? Let me count the ways. I'll start with the humanist part. Michael Mann accepts the tenets of humanism, but more to the point, he puts his beliefs into action. He was the inaugural speaker at the Congressional Thomas Paine Breakfast. What is the Thomas Paine Breakfast? It is the far superior alternative to what I call the world's worst breakfast, otherwise known as the Congressional Prayer Breakfast. This far superior alternative is put on by the Congressional Freethought Caucus, and I am so glad that that caucus exists. We need them. As to the of the year part, this barely begins to cover it. I assert that climate scientist Dr. Michael Mann is the most consequential scientist of our era. I use this word carefully. I did not say that he is the most cutting edge, though some of his work has been a true technical tour de force. He has not been a lone wolf howling in the wilderness. In fact, he has proudly worked with other scientists around the world. But what he did do is publish the most important graph to the future of humanity. It's this graph. This is the famous hockey stick graph. This graph shows that world temperature was overall remarkably stable since about the year 1000 and then started to spike precipitously upward starting in the mid-1800s. This graph is famous around the world. It was the centerpiece for the Academy Award-winning film, An Inconvenient Truth. It has clarified the reality of global warming and shown the urgency of the problem. Anyone can understand this graph. And since global warming is an existential threat, this graph is the most important graph to the future of humanity. And for that reason, it has also created a backlash. Not a scientific backlash. In fact, it will come as no surprise to you to hear that scientists are often equipped with healthy egos. But this means that if one scientist can take down another one's research, we'll go for it. But we haven't, because Dr. Mann's research is solid. But the attacks by global warming denialists became even more vicious, even as predictions came true. The state of Virginia demanded access to his emails. Does this sound familiar? His emails from the Climate Research Unit were hacked, and Dr. Mann was then falsely accused of data manipulation and falsification. He was subjected to multiple investigations, including by the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. Republican state senators from Pennsylvania threatened to hold his university's funding hostage until appropriate action was taken against him. Senator James Inhofe, about whom we heard earlier today, demanded investigations and cold hearings to question the entirety of climate change science. Former Representative Joe Barton sent Mann and his colleagues a threatening letter disguised as a subpoena calling for an open-ended investigation into Mann and his colleagues. He later called for Mann and 16 other climate scientists to be criminally prosecuted, arguing that they may have engaged in potentially criminal behavior punishable by prison. The personal attacks have been relentless. Detractors have called for his arrest. He has been accused of scientific fascism whatever that is. The enemies of science have said that he deserves to be publicly flogged, drawn, and quartered, and that he should commit suicide. He has, of course, received death threats and threats to his family. He also received white powder in an envelope meant to instill terror in him by simulating an anthrax attack. It turned out to be cornstarch, but only after the FBI arrived and his office was sealed with police tape. But Michael Mann stuck to it. He didn't back down. So, who is this guy? He received bachelor's degrees in physics and applied mathematics from Berkeley, 3 separate master's degrees from Yale, and a PhD in geology and geophysics from Yale University. He was the distinguished professor of atmospheric science at Penn State University. He is now the presidential distinguished professor in the Department of Earth and Environmental Science at the University of Pennsylvania. Along the way, he was one of the authors of the report from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change that was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 2007. This whole thing got started in 1998. In that year, Dr. Mann, as a postdoctoral researcher, published a paper in the journal Nature with 2 other scientists that contained the original version of this graph. Since then, he has published more than 200 scientific papers. But here's the real kicker. In the intervening decades, even while climate deniers were throwing everything they had at the hockey stick graph, other scientists, using different methods and different approaches, arrived at the same conclusion. The result is that the original hockey stick became a hockey team, and it is now a whole hockey league. These graphs were arrived at through different means, and they all show the same thing. And though Dr. Mann may have started with the innocent scientific belief that facts will speak for themselves, when he found out that this isn't true, he pushed back. And pushed back. And pushed back. In addition to all the publishing, he has sued some of his detractors when their lies were too egregious. He also took to popular media and made his case there. He wrote in newspapers and appeared on television, on Twitter. After a climate denier said that, quote, 87% of the fires in Australia are arson, and this is not the worst they have had, unquote. Dr. Mann responded that, quote, 100% of your tweet is BS. So although he became a lightning rod for all the crap that the wretched and powerful can throw at us, he stood up to it. He's still working and still telling us what we need to know. So he's done it all. He did the science. He made it accessible. He attracted all the horrors of a shitstorm from the rich and powerful, and he stuck to it. And he's one of us. And I say that if he can do it, then so can we. He richly deserves the award of Humanist of the Year. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Dr. Michael Mann.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you. I'm so sorry I can't be there in person to receive the award, but it's great to be with all of you here virtually today. Yeah, I just couldn't be more honored to be named Humanist of the Year by the American Humanist Association. I want to offer special thanks to Abby Hafer, for that wonderful introduction that you just provided, perhaps the best introduction I've ever received. Nicole Carr, the awards committee, my family, the countless friends and colleagues who have provided me with support and counsel and friendship over the years. When I look at the list of past recipients of this award, it reads like a who's who of my personal heroes and role models, folks like Tony Fauci, Stephen Jay Gould, Margaret Atwood, Isaac Asimov, Jonas Salk, Buckminster Fuller, Margaret Sanger, and of course, Carl Sagan. I'll have more to say about him later. I'm delighted to see some personal friends on the list of past awardees, including Bill Nye, Congressman Jared Huffman, and science journalist Jennifer Ouellette. And I also have to say I'm reassured to see certain past awards have been retracted. To quote the influential thinker Stan Lee, with great power comes great responsibility. There is a rightful expectation that those who are bestowed such accolades will continue to honor the values that undergird them. Now, while we're on the topic of values, I must confess that when I was first contacted about the prospect of being awarded Humanist of the Year, I did have to ponder the implications of accepting the award. Humanism is sometimes wrongly equated with atheism, and while I myself am agnostic about the existence of a creator, like Sagan, I see no evidence for one and no need to invoke one to explain our world and our universe. I also recognize, as Sagan did, that people of faith can be an important part of the coalitions that exist to advance many of the causes, such as environmental preservation, that I hold dear. And I see no reason to provoke them and alienate these potential allies. I reflected on what it means to be a humanist. To me, it means that we can find meaning in the human condition without appealing to the supernatural, deities, demons, and angels, heaven and hell, and afterlife. It means that we can draw upon the tools of reason to illuminate the path forward, that rationality and science can indeed serve as a candle in the vast darkness of our universe. Now consider the great physicist Leo Szilard. He was the recipient of this award in 1960. Szilard was a great physicist, but more importantly, he was a great human being. He used his brilliant mind not only to solve fundamental problems in physics, but to fight back against a rising tide of fascism in the 1930s. Nearly a century later, that battle is self-evidently not over. Szilard also founded the Council for a Livable World in 1962. That battle too is unfortunately not over, as we deal simultaneously with the threats of an unprecedented pandemic, renewed nuclear tensions, and the greatest crisis of all, the climate crisis. I was humbled to receive the Leo Szilard Award of the American Physical Society last year for my own science outreach efforts. As it happens, I got my start in the same subfield as Szilard, statistical physics. Depending on your perspective, I either saw the light or lost my way. Mid-PhD, I set out on a self-avoiding random walk. Sorry, that's a gratuitous statistical physics reference. And I ended up applying my math and physics training to problems in the burgeoning field of climate science. Ultimately, my forays would lead to the now iconic hockey stick curve of which you heard previously. It illustrates the unprecedented warming of recent decades. We first published the hockey stick in the journal Nature on April 22nd, that's Earth Day, 1998. So it just celebrated its 25th birthday. The hockey stick is based on natural recorders of climate called proxy records, such as tree rings and corals and ice cores, which stretch centuries back in time beyond the relatively short instrumental record of the past century and a half. Using a large set of proxy records spanning the globe, we reconstructed Earth's temperature changes over the past six centuries, and then a year later, the past 1,000 years. The resulting plot, with its upturned blade, characterizing the dramatic warming of the past century, tells a simple story that we are causing profound changes in our climate through the continued burning of fossil fuels. That made it inconvenient to fossil fuel interests and the conservative politicians and media outlets that promote their agenda. And I would indeed find myself at the very center of the fractious debate over human-caused climate change. As you heard previously, climate change deniers spent decades trying to discredit the hockey stick, often by going after me personally. Yet 25 years later, there is, as you heard, also a veritable hockey league, dozens of independent reconstructions of past temperature change that not only reaffirm our original findings, but extend them. The latest studies now suggest that the warming of the planet in recent decades is unprecedented in tens of thousands of years, and perhaps hundreds of thousands of years. We are engaged in an unprecedented and uncontrolled experiment with the only planet we know that can serve as a home for us and other living things. There is, as they say, no planet B. Despite the bruising battles as I've sought to defend the science of climate change, including my own work, from attacks by vested interests aiming to discredit it, I consider myself privileged to have found myself in a position to influence the public discourse over the greatest challenge we face as a civilization. Efforts to attack and deny the scientific evidence for human-caused climate change have long constituted a major impediment to action. But as I argued in The New Climate War, we appear now to be moving past outright denial of the basic science as the evidence becomes plain to the person on the street, in the form of unprecedented heat waves, droughts, wildfires, floods, and superstorms that we are now witnessing in real time. We still, however, face a multi-pronged strategy by polluters and their enablers in the media and pundit class to distract, deflect, attack, divide, and delay. Among their preferred tactics today is the promotion of risky, unproven strategies such as geoengineering, or massive carbon capture and sequestration, and the promise of future action as an excuse for business as usual fossil fuel burning today. There is still time for us to avert the worst impacts of climate change if we act now and we act boldly. But there is no time left for dead ends, wrong turns, and false solutions. We have the technology in the form of renewable energy, storage and efficiency and conservation measures. The only obstacles at this point aren't the laws of physics, but the flaws in our politics. The past offers us many lessons, indeed, when it comes to the defining challenge of our time. We must learn from those lessons and share them with the public through every means available to us. Indeed, it's the theme of my forthcoming book, Our Fragile Moment, How Lessons from Earth's Past Can Help Us Survive the Climate Crisis. Last year, I received an honorary degree at UC Leuven in Belgium. The theme of the ceremony was La Fragilité du Vrai, the fragility of truth. I can't imagine a more poignant theme given the crossroads we are at today. For the fragility of truth is more evident than it has ever been. And that fragility now poses an existential threat to society, human civilization, and indeed our planetary home. More than two decades ago, the great Carl Sagan, an Earth and planetary scientist, and perhaps the greatest science communicator of our generation, warned in his masterful tome, The Demon-Haunted World, of a time in his children or grandchildren's future, a time when, quote, awesome technological powers are in the hands of a very few, and no one representing the public interest can even grasp the issues, when the people have lost the ability to set their own agendas or knowledgeably question those in authority, quote. When, quote, our critical faculties in decline, we slide almost without noticing back into superstition and darkness. He feared a, quote, dumbing down, most evident in the slow decay of substantive content in the enormously influential media, the 30-second sound bites, now down to 10 seconds or less, lowest common denominator programming, credulous presentations on pseudoscience and superstition, but especially a kind of celebration of ignorance, a celebration of ignorance. Alas, Carl Sagan's first grandchild was born into the very era he foretold. His daughter, Sasha, a friend of mine, a deep thinker and talented author in her own right, gave birth to his first granddaughter just a few years ago. Our ongoing reliance on fossil fuels is, in fact, at the root of the twin battles we are fighting right now, a battle on the one hand to defend the fledgling democracy of Ukraine and indeed Western democracy itself from a brutal, barbarous assault by an authoritarian petrostate led by a ruthless despot, Vladimir Putin. And there is, of course, the greatest battle of all, the battle to avert catastrophic climate change while there is still time. That battle has been made all the more challenging by rampant disinformation, by polluters and special interests, by right-wing politicians, conservative media, and bad state actors like Russia that have flooded our online information ecosystem with falsehoods and outright lies. Social media, the primary means by which many people obtain their daily diet of information today, have increasingly been weaponized by bad actors for nefarious purposes to undermine faith in governmental and civic institutions, our traditional media, expert opinion, and yes, scientists, whose views and findings might prove inconvenient to their political, financial, or ideological agenda. That includes public health experts like Tony Fauci, the last recipient of this award, who have provided informed advice on how to deal with an unprecedented pandemic. And it also includes climate scientists offering our informed advice when it comes to the climate crisis. Our mission as scientists, academics, thought leaders, indeed as humanists, has literally never been more important than it is right now. We must step up and do battle in what is genuinely, a genuinely Tolkien-esque battle assault on science, reason, and fact-based discourse. Truth has never been more fragile, nor has our planet. It is up to all of us to defend both before it is truly too late. Thank you.
So, Dr. Mann is going to take a few questions from our audience. So,
hi, I'm Robert Franklin from Idaho, and I'm not sure which camera to look at, so I'll just look around.
I see you. Hi.
Oh,
good to
go.
See you.
Hi. I would like to ask you what you know, in this is the preload here, is there's a lot of people that I know that are into solar power and alternative energy sources, electric cars, and extremely passionate about that. And at the same time, they're 100% opposed to nuclear power. And I wonder if you had some opinions on small nuclear reactors and its potential to solve the climate change problem.
Yeah, thanks for the question. It's an important one, and it's a nuanced and complicated one. I personally feel that it's important to have that conversation. Nuclear energy, as you allude to, sort of small modular reactors, there's some promise in this newer, potentially safer technology that can be deployed widely, these more modular reactors. There's some potential promise there. At the same time, I have often argued that we should probably continue those, you know, nuclear power plants that are running safely through their, through their natural lifetime, because that's essentially a sunken carbon cost. We've already put the energy and investment into those nuclear reactors, and they provide carbon-free energy today. So it makes sense to run them out through their natural lifetime. When it comes to new nuclear infrastructure, and that can be, you know, large-scale nuclear power plants, it could be new nuclear technology, modular reactors, there are a couple factors that we have to keep in mind here. One is, frankly, just expense. It turns out that nuclear energy is actually a lot, much more costly, on a levelized basis, then nuclear energy is much more costly on a levelized basis than the various forms of renewable energy. And so we have to be careful that we're not crowding out by investing in a more expensive technology, a cheaper technology that can be scaled up to meet our energy needs potentially on the time frame that's necessary. Small modular reactors, you know, 10 years down the road, 20 years down the road, these could prove very promising. They could prove to be a promising source of non-carbon generating energy. Here's the challenge. We've got to reduce our carbon emissions by 50% within this decade and down to net zero by the middle of the century. But a 50% reduction by 2030, that's not going to be accomplished with new technology that may take, you know, decades to deploy at scale. It can be accomplished with existing renewable energy technology. And so my argument would be, let's move forward with the solutions we have right now while we continue to invest in some of these other solutions that may be important down the road, ultimately even including things like massive carbon capture. If we decide we've actually got to bring carbon dioxide levels back down to prevent catastrophic long-term climate consequences, we're going to need new technology to do that. So let's continue with the development of that technology, but let's not allow people to use it as a crutch for inaction today, because we do have the tools to begin decarbonizing our economy now.
Thank you, Dr. Mann. At the end of your wonderful speech, you said before it's too late. Could you possibly describe, because I don't believe we go into this enough at all, what does it look like if it does get too late? What happens to human existence? What happens to life on Earth after it gets too late? I don't believe that is described enough. And I believe that if it was described enough, it might be able to make more of an impact.
Yeah, thanks. There's that sentence packs quite a lot into it. And we could have a whole hour-long conversation about the consequences of various levels of warming. We're not going to do that here today, of course. It is one of the things that I do get into in, our fragile moment, sort of what lessons we can learn from the past about these potentially critical thresholds that we could, in fact, exceed if we continue with business as usual. So here's the good news. We've made enough progress already that we are now on a path to keep warming below 3.6 or so degrees Celsius, less than 4 degrees Celsius. If we warm the planet 4 degrees Celsius, that would have catastrophic consequences. It wouldn't mean the end of humanity as we know it. It wouldn't mean the end of our planet as we know it, but it would be a fundamentally degraded planet that would resemble sort of the dystopian visions that Hollywood has provided us. So that's if we do nothing further, if we continue with the sort of slow decarbonization that's already happening based on the policies that are already in place, we will keep warming below a level that's likely to lead to the end of civilization as we know it. On the other hand, if we, double down, we actually end up making negative progress, getting rid of policies that we've already put in place, and we decide to scrap the clean energy transition altogether, and there's some powerful actors who would like nothing more than to see that happen, then we cannot rule out, based on the lessons that we can draw from past extinctions, we can't rule out a sort of extinction level climate crisis, levels of warming and massive destabilization that would render human civilization, impossible in anything resembling its current form. All right, so those are still two bad scenarios. One's the end of civilization, one's not maybe the end of civilization, but a dystopian world. We don't want either of those worlds. And so the reality is that if we can accomplish those reductions that I mentioned, 50% reduction in carbon emissions over the next decade, and that's doable. The obstacles are not physical, they're not technological, they are entirely political. If we can do that, then we keep warming within the range of our adaptive capacity. There will be challenges. We're already seeing those challenges. We're already seeing truly dangerous consequences in the form of, you know, unprecedented wildfires and heat waves and superstorms and floods. We see this sort of constant parade of these sorts of events now on our television screens. We're already seeing catastrophic impacts, but we can sort of keep that, we can keep the climate within the range of our adaptive capacity and the adaptive capacity of other living things, of ecosystems, if we can rise to the challenge and we can create a better world for future generations. That is still within the realm of possibility. And one of the greatest threats today, ironically, is sort of doomism, this idea that it's too late to do anything because it potentially leads us down the same path of inaction as outright denial.
I have to look at the camera instead of you. I assume you know Dr. Steve Running. Right, yeah, so he recently gave a speech about all of this climate stuff to, so he's another climate modelist who happens to be from Montana. And he recently gave a presentation to a bunch of us in Billings, Montana. And because of that, we put together a Climate Week series of events featuring Dr. Steve Running. And it also turns out that we're doing it the week of June 5th, and the week of June 12th is when the very first of the Youth v. Gov cases are coming to a court in Montana. You know, and I was just kind of wondering, are you one of the people who are coming to Montana in order to testify in that case?
I am not, unfortunately, but I do know that there's some very talented and informed scientists who are. Steve Running's a friend of mine. I've often thought that he should make a silent film. He could call it Silent Running. Sorry, that's a terrible joke. But there's a 1970s dystopian movie starring Bruce Dern, and if you haven't seen it, you should check it out. It's called Silent Running, and it's actually about one of those dystopian futures, one of those futures that we could inherit if we fail to rise to this challenge.
That's all we have time for. So thank you very much, Dr. Mann.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody.
Once again, thank you, Dr. Mann, for joining us tonight remotely. We do appreciate it. And thank you for accepting our award. That concludes the awards banquet. In a few moments, we'll enjoy a performance by R&B artist Lenny Harold. And Dr. Alexander will be signing his books just outside the ballroom, so you can get your book signed while you listen to the music and then come back to the ballroom to enjoy it more.
for. Mm-hmm. He said he want, yeah, he wants it, he wanted him right here is what he was saying, but this that should be work if we push it back a little bit. Just so we can see. Here we go.
Looking to get everybody settled, kicking us back in. Thank you so much.